In painting, how I use color in painting, it's a bit different from sketching with lines and then filling with color. Each painting process is slightly different from painting the color of things. It's more like a decision of the whole picture. Pretty much it's more of a whole picture than, you know, I see a car and red, a house and yellow, and then I paint the color. Not so much of that. That is more like telling you what I see. But this case is more like making a decision for the whole picture. Not so much about painting each thing. So you can see like sometimes I use a lot of odd colors, but there's a reason for it. Alright? So anyway, now let me start on the slide. I've forgotten what I prepared, you know. So maybe I'm talking some nonsense. But anyway, the weather is so warm outside, it's better to sit inside. Okay, anyway, now you go to the market, you will see this. I now ordered from Amazon. Yeah, you'll see this, but I erase the price and all this so that you don't waste your money. Yeah, you really don't want to buy it from Amazon. I don't recommend you buy it from Amazon because why? This is old school stuff, it's like 100 years ago and it's out of date and it's really not so good for you. Yeah, so if you haven't learned anything about color, it's good for you to buy this. This is what you see from Amazon, and then you rotate around and get colors. And then they teach you how to use color combination and all this. Why am I telling you? No, you want to see this. Next one. Okay, now this is the one that poisons you. Just now that one is the practical form. This one is the one that the theory behind. It's called Eaton Color View. Now, Eaton is the one that an artist and scientist they're working with the Bauhaus School. If you study art history, you probably know. In Germany, all these people like Kandinsky, Paul Klee, and all these people in Bauhaus School, they try to come up theory about how we behave visually, and they want to use the science. You know, Germans are very good at science, so they want to use science to explain everything. But you know, today it's not successful. Anyway, now if you want to know more about it, you can study the art history. But anyway, I just want to tell you, this thing is more than 100 years ago. And believe me, it's not fully functional. So don't buy the color view that you see in the market. It's not working. Okay? And what the fact is, it's treating everything as symmetrical. Now, the main thing I want to tell you here is, all colors, they are not the same. Okay, now ask you one question. Can you make yellow color dark? Okay, now I give you yellow color. Can you paint a picture? Are you able to paint a picture with yellow color? Just yellow color. It's very difficult, isn't it? You can, but it's quite difficult because you can't get it dark. Right, so, no stuff? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, now, so that tells you, you know, if I give you blue color or purple color, you can get it really dark. So there's not much problem if you have that color. But yellow color, you'll have trouble. Right. So that tells you every color is different. Now I want to show you the next one. Now this is the real one, you know, that overcomes the problem. This is Mansell color view. Mansell is another scientist that's slightly later than the Bauhaus group people. But the family is too good at making money. Why I want to say that? You know, today you go to buy paint, but in the paint shop you choose color for your house, those paint that you choose is color chart and all this. They have pattern color reference, they have all kind of reference. Now all the money, the license, goes to this family. Okay? Now Mansell came out with a whole color, practical color scheme to show you. Now you can see that this is asymmetrical, it's not symmetrical. Now yellow color, you can never get it dark. When it turns dark, it becomes green color. So yellow plus black gets you green color. Right. So if you want green color, you can take the yellow color plus black color, you get green color. Now why? What is the reason? Now how to make black color? Anyone? How to make black color? You mix color, tell how to make black color. If let's say you don't have black color today. Yeah, you mix all up together, right? Basically, you have all the primary color mixes together, you get almost black. Right? which one of the color that you have got. Let's say now you have blue, you have red, you have yellow. You try to mix them together and you get some sort of black color. So which component you think the most? Is it blue or red or yellow? Which one? Blue is more, right? So in a way, you see, now if you have yellow color, I mix with black. In a way, it's like mixing with a kind of dirty color, blue, isn't it? So yellow plus blue, everyone know is green color. And that's how you get green color. You see that? So actually, now the main thing I want to emphasize here is the color play itself is not symmetrical. So if you have orange red color, you can only reach the middle. You have yellow, it's on top. You have like a yellowish green is on top. Only you have blue, you have black, you have dark blue, and then you have purple, you have dark brown, then it goes as low as like really dark tone. Not every single color will give you the same tone. That's the main thing. So if you want to try to paint dark yellow, there's no such thing. Right? So remember that. Okay, now these are the three main things that we look at when we go with color. The trouble of color using color is we cannot segregate all these three attributes. The tone is the darkness and lightness. Just now we just talked about it. You know, some colors they just bright, some colors just they can stretch from light to dark. You know, and then some colors reaching the middle. But the next thing about color is the difference of color is the hue itself. The difference between color. So if you, let's say the two colors, they have the same kind of tone, you can't differentiate them. But you can still differentiate them through the difference in color. Now, of course, the further it is on the wheel, the more difference you get. Okay, we will talk about that later. And then the last attribute of color is the pureness of the color. In Photoshop, it says saturation. Right? But it all means the same thing. Intensity, chroma, saturation, it all means the same thing. If you want a scientific definition, there's some difference. But practically to me and to all of us that use it, no difference. Right? It's talking about the purity of the color itself. So other than talking about which color you use, that's the hue, right? And then the purity of the color. And then of course the darkness and lightness of the color, or even some people like to call it value. But value sometimes can be very confusing because you use value for many, many things. Right? So I prefer the word tone. Right? And then the tone that you can use an adjective like toner, you know, but value there's no adjective, I don't know what adjective you use. Right? Okay, now this is like a one that tries to show the different tones of color. See that yellow can only stretch a little bit. Now if you go to blue, it can stretch longer, you see that? There's a different range of tones that you can get for different colors. Okay, now of course, the darkness and lightness is in the vertical axis of this three-dimensional diagram. Now the pureness is an outermost ring. Okay, and then inside is all the different kind of browns. Unfortunately, I don't have a 3D version. I have a student that's programming it. So next time, we will distribute the three-dimensional version. Then you can make all kinds of pictures. I just got the money to do that. Got the programmer to program everything, and then you can do mapping and analysis of pictures. Yeah. Okay, now. So because of that, right, now you treat colors by currency. Now you don't use the same currency. You go to different country and you want to buy the same value of things, it's different. So you got to think of it like, you know, like currency. Like you go to different country, you use different currency and it's just different. So it occupies a different size of color space. So how to resolve this problem? It's so complex. Now this color space is so complex that how do we practically resolve the problem when we use color? Our palette is just flat, right? So that's why I come up with some system to do that. Now this is the very first one. Now if you want to train your tone, right? This is one of the very good exercises. Now I put my student did a very nice format and exercise, like an exercise book in the book, so you can read it step by step and do the exercise. My student did this book for me, and then he designed it. So you have a step by step thing. So now you know how to train tone in color. You can do it in 5 rounds, just half an hour, and you master all the tones. No need to learn it in a hardcore manner, like practice the charcoal drawing and all this. No need. Just practice these 5 times, you will master all the phones really easy. Okay, how to do that? Now, pretty simple. Everyone got a phone, right? Your phone got a grayscale. Correct? So when you play the tower, take with the phone in the grayscale and look at the tone, what it is. So then you will know what tone it is. Now, see how many you can judge it correctly. Now, the biggest problem generally is lining in between. See now, I have some mistakes. Can you see that? Yeah. They are not aligned with the gray. See that? Now, those are the wrong ones. So you have to redo. Until you get all the right ones, and then memorize it, or eat it, or burn it, and eat it, or drink it in water, whatever method. Yeah. All the color you use, you got to master the tone. No chance if you don't know the tone. Right? Because you don't need to know the difference in order to show the difference. Right? So if you use your colors, you got to really master the tone, just like how my physics teacher said, you know, if I wake you up midnight, you got to memorize to me Newton's three laws. If I wake you up midnight, you'll be able to tell me what phone this is. Right? Okay, phone 7, you know. Yeah. If I wake you up before midnight, you can tell me what phone it is. Right. So memorize all the tones, but not memorize before you do that, you have to practice and get it right first. Right. And the most difficult one is not the middle one, but unfortunately, that's the one that you need. Because why? See, if you have maximum contrast of 1 and 9, it's useless. Because the music is at the middle. Right? If you want the rhythm, you got to add in the middle keys to keep the music, right? So how fast and how slow you sing the music all depends on the middle keys. Right? How you arrange the middle keys. So you need all the middle ones to arrange all kind of rhythm. Right? So if you only know the darkest dark and the lightest light, it's not going to help you. So that's number one. So the only thing to do it is to really, really know every single tone accurately. No guessing. Alright, so that's step one. And you can see like, when I put the color, you can see everyone has got different tone. See that? Yeah. Okay, the next one. Now, so, now, see, just like, that's not the question I asked. See, it's not easy to paint with yellow. You can't even see the color difference. Right, because that's the darkest you can get. Even I use auto, that's the darkest you can get. So there's not much tonal difference you get for the yellow, so it's very hard for you to paint a picture in that case. Right. So now if I want to paint, okay, like this is a snowy scene. How do I paint the snow? How? You know, I don't really paint the snow actually. I paint the not snow. Isn't it? Now, in order to paint the snow, I'll give you snow. If I say, okay, let's paint a very heavy snowy day. So I just paint in my paper. Isn't it? That's very heavy, isn't it? Don't see anything. It's just white. Right? So if you want to show the snow, you will show the not snow. And that is the tonal difference. So you can't pick white color and paint, isn't it? You got to pick the difference, right? All the different colors that has got darker tone to show the not snow, isn't it? Right? So see that if you are sketching things and trying to fill in the blank and fill out all the things, it's not going to get you anywhere. How you want to paint is through comparison of the tones. So that's why you need to know every single tone or every single color. No excuse. You won't be able to get anything without knowing what tone each thing is. Because you're not only painting the thing, you're also painting the differences. So the differences is not maximum difference only. It's also comparing the rhythm of all these middle ones, how much difference you get. Right, so the difference you get in different amount will get you different kind of arrangement of tone, and that gets you the different kind of rhythm of arrangement, and that's your music that you design, isn't it? In terms of tone itself only. We haven't even touched hue and intensity. Right, so that's the first thing. Okay, so now you see now, actually I just show a chart. Now this is the original painting. Now the tone key is like I have a very bright region that is maybe around this region, and then most of it is from the middle to the dark. Right, so this is the tonal key. Now, see if I change the tonal key, right, immediately it changes to different mode. See that this becomes like a very moody picture. Even with the same kind of drawing picture that you have, but it's changing mode because I shift the key. Yeah, so by designing the key difference of all this. Now, okay, the 1 to 9 is the Mansell scale that everybody uses. Mansell is a very Right, so we know like one is the lightest mind and nine is the darkest star. So everyone talking with the same skill and then we can understand each other. And nine skill is enough to describe everything, so we don't have to go to 1.5, 1.25 and all this. But if, of course when you're painting it's a continuous thing, but there's no need to go to the kind of skill because the main skill will give you most of the design that you need. Right? So that's the thing. So now you see, if you change the skill, right, if you squeeze the tone key, you're going to get a different mode. Like the light is dark now, the dark is not so dark. See that? So you have a very moody picture. And the whole tonal design is going to be like somewhere in the middle. Isn't it? That's why it's so moody. So you see like all these tones, and then you're going to match with the color that you're going to use to get you this kind of mood. Right? Now, normally when I work, right, this is how I do. I do a tonal study. And then I know like you know, where is dark, where is light, and then I will choose the respective color to paint. So you see like when I have a tonal study, when I paint, I'm very confident I can go in and cover up the areas with the right tone. And that's how the picture will turn out like. I don't know why it's being smaller. Yeah, it used to be bigger, but yeah, anyway, this is the picture. So you see the tonal range gives you the mood that you need. Right, so if you design with the right tone, the color and then you can pick the right color. So you see my dark color, I can never use yellow or red or whatever. It has to be some sort of dark color. But some of the middle tone, I have some yellowish brown and all that. Okay, now I come up with an easier system. Because it's like a palette. Now I call it like a, it's from the Munsell color space just now. Now if you can imagine, just now, back to just now this slide. Okay, this one. Now if you can imagine this, okay, now you squeeze it down. Okay, take the whole thing, you squeeze it down, this is what you get. Okay, this is what you get. A smiling face like this. Okay? Now at the middle is all the brown color. Now, okay, and I don't like the arrangement of how these artists do it. Actually, I get from Harvey Brown in his book, this Munsell color wheel. It's a wheel now, it's no more a space. It's flat now, it's a wheel. But I don't like his arrangement, although the smiling face is nice. I change it to this format. Now, anybody have ever been confused by a whole color, one color, and all this thing? Anyone? Okay, now, from now on, don't worry about that, it's pretty easy. Why? Actually, all these guys that came out with this whole color, one color, and all this thing, only confuse you. So don't get confused, you know how? There's no need to remember that. Because why? All they try to tell you is the color is nearer to red, orange, or yellow, or is nearer to blue or green, right? But sometimes we can also cross in this manner, isn't it? So there's no such thing as warm and cold. Now give me an example. Let's say I use this color, and then I use this color. Are they the same temperature? Yeah, they are the same temperature. They are falling in the same level on the color view, right? Because this is coolest part, this is the hottest part, right? So if I'm aligned here, I'm in the same temperature, isn't it? Correct? Right? But are they the same color? No. So, the temperature thing confuses you because why? In this case, it's still a different color. So it's still different. In hue, it's still different. In temperature, it's the same. Right? So don't get the temperature thing anymore. No use. That one is useless. Why? Because it tends to confuse you. You only compare difference. Now the easiest way is, the further it is, the more difference you get in color. That's all it means. Okay, so all you need to remember, three colors. One, blue color, the other, yellow, and red color. And then you know orange is in between. That's all you need to remember. And then orange, red, yellow, one side, blue, one side. Middle is green, the other side is purple. It's that simple, right? So when you talk about color, don't care about temperature, just care about which direction it goes towards. Right? Is this color more towards purple or more towards orange or more towards yellow? Now of course when it's more towards yellow, it works with yellow easily. Now when it's more towards green, it works with green easily. Now, don't worry anything about temperature, just use your eye and look at it. Is this more green or more yellow? Your eye will tell you. You still get things every day. and try to paint, you won't be able to get anything. Why? Because you get comfortable. When you stare at a thing, your eyes go to adjust and you feel more comfortable. And that is a problem. Because why? Your eyes is dynamic. It gets you more comfortable so that you feel better in life. That's natural. Your brain is doing that.
Well, now I have a question. Why is the secondary color orange small compared to the other two secondary color pieces?
Oh no, I'm just trying to show you that this chart is trying to use the primary as five primary based on the Mansell's original concept, but it's no difference to words practically. Yeah, it's the basic concept that Mansell applied by using five primary because he knows the color space is non-linear. But it doesn't affect us. All we need to remember is which color is nearer to which zone, that's all. So that it doesn't confuse you like the color view of these two pair will work, that two pair will work. No, it doesn't work. Because why? It's different. It's different in color space. All you need to remember is the best way, if you don't remember, buy a big palette, mix it and see it yourself. How far is it? Right? Because anyway it's non-linear. So when you mix on your palette, you will see it. Yeah. So actually like one of my professors told me this when we learned oil painting, 75% to 80% of the paint is not painted on the canvas, it's wasted on the palette. Yeah. Why? Because you mix and see. Right? So you mix things, it's not correct, you wipe it, you mix things, it's not correct, you wipe it. But also you mix as a reference. Okay? So if you put the red color down, you put the blue color down, you put the brown color down, you mix and they call pool color in by oil painter and they put it together so you can see the mixture, how fast and how slow each one changes to which. Right? So in a way, it's because they cannot visualize the three-dimensional space so easily, they use the palette. Yeah. So from there you gain the experience. So although you don't know the world map, but you know how to get home. Right? You know? Because you travel the road, you know, a few rounds. So you know this road, that road, that road, I can get home, you know? Yeah, something like that. But you don't know the whole map actually. Yeah. Even if you live in Bangkok, you may not know the whole Bangkok map, right? But you know how to get home. Right? Because you know the road, you know, like this, it's like your palette. You don't know the color space, but you have your palette, you mix, and then you know how fast it changes. Right, so from experience, you know, okay, this is the fast, the speed and how it changes. So then you gain the experience. Right, so the best is use a big palette if you want to paint. Yeah. So this case, now this is to help you so that you don't get confused by hue anymore. Right, the hue thing is really one big aspect that you want to master other than the tone. So now you are playing with tone, the darkness and lightness different, and also the color difference. So how to play with the color difference? The further it is, the more difference you get. The nearer it is, the more friendly you get. Right. So that's how I came up with a system called friends and enemy color. Now this is just now that Mansell chart. This is the darkness and lightness, that's the color, and then the outside is the purest part. Now, in actual fact, if you go to the Mansell color space, now green color is very very white. So yeah, that tells you how non-linear it is. So if you want to paint a green painting, you can do it, but you want to paint a yellow painting, it's quite difficult. That's the reason. Look at how small the yellow region is when they map up in the scientific method. It's very small and the green is very big. So you can paint a lot of green paintings, but you can't do yellow painting anyway. Right? Now, this is what I mean, the difference. Now see, you can contrast green. Now there's like now when I teach students, I tell them this. Now when you use green color, you don't treat them like one color. You treat them like three different colors. There's like yellowish green. Now you can quite see it on the screen, but this is like a bluish green, that is greenish green. It sounds funny, greenish green, but it's that. But that's how I teach the student how to differentiate color. There's a man in the middle, and then one is nearer to the blue, the other is nearer to the yellow. And you don't treat them like same color, because they can give you hue contrast. Now you can't get much hue contrast from yellow itself, right? But you can get hue contrast from green. That's why green color sometimes is quite hard to use, because people just think like it's green color. They never think of which area is nearer to, you know, like which color it is nearer to. So that's why when they use green, they're confused. That is the main reason. Okay, now this is what, if you want to look at the master who paint the best green painting, look at Shishkin, Russian painter, paints the fantastic landscape. I don't quite see it in projector here, probably you see the screen, you can see it very nice. Yeah. So you see that it's green handy, at least yellowing screen, you can get a lot of color out of it. I'm sorry, but I'm not so clear in here, but you can go and Google Shiskin. You'll find a lot of nice landscape painting in green, in different sort of green. This is probably one of the best landscape painter in green for the whole history of midnight. Okay, now this is the thing that I showed you, three different greens you get. Okay, and then this is how the color space stretch in your method. Can you see that? Okay, so now the next one you can do is, after you can master hue and tone, you can play with the pureness. Now if you use the purest color, it gets even more difference. Now from the yellow to the red, you can see a lot of difference. Right, in the purest zone. The vector is further away. Right. Okay, now this is the new system. I sort of came out. Just now the smiley springs, I rotate it. So I have the red here, and the blue here, and the red, orange, yellow here. Now, why I want to show you this? Now, the question is, just now I just mentioned black is blue color, right? Okay, so you want to also know the respective browns. Now, of course, everybody know yellow ochre is dinner to yellow. No problem, right? Huh? Okay, so now if you take the black and it mix with the yellow ochre, you get green color. That's the green color you get. Yeah, that's sort of like the black color. Okay, now you have burnt sienna. Now, which color is nearer to? It's about red and orange, isn't it? Okay, so if you take the black, you mix with burnt sienna, what do you get? Black color mixed with burnt sienna, I think I've already used that. What do you get?
Dark brown.
Dark brown, isn't it? Okay, now, so if your black is blue color, now your burnt sienna is red color. Now, blue plus red, what do you get?
Purple
color, isn't it? So that tells you your dark brown is a purple color. Isn't it? Right or not? Okay, you have red plus blue, you get purple color, right? You have burnt sienna plus black, you get dark brown, right? So this is corresponding to purple color. Get it now? So dark brown is a dirty version of purple color. Get it? Now of course there are different types of dark brown. Some dark brown is more red, some dark brown is more blue. Right? So if it's nearer to the black, it's more blue. If it's nearer to the red, it's more red, definitely, right? If it's nearer to the red brown or whatever, Manchiana, then it's more red. So now you know how this is useful? Because see, just now we were talking about how you create rhythm in your painting, right? With tone, correct? With the toner design, remember the toner thing that we do? Just now we look at it. Okay, now same thing goes to color. Now when you want to design color, you don't always contrast color between this and that, right? Sometimes you need the browns. But how will you know which brown to use? Right? Now, how you use it depending on how much difference you want to get. Like, give you an example. Let's say you have a blue, now you want to use, but you don't want to use orange. You want to create some difference, but you don't want too much difference. So you can use some brown that is in this region. Correct? It's not too far, it doesn't stretch to the maximum, but it gives you enough difference. Now, if you want a brown that is nearer to the blue, you take brown that is nearer. Right? Now, same thing goes to purple. So that's why if you want to use purple color, but you want it so pure, you use dark brown. You see that? That's why the dark brown color goes with the purple easily. Yeah. You don't know the reason, but it's when you paint the dark brown or paint the purple, it just works. Now, that's another question. Now, you know what's the reason. When I wrote to some graphic artists when I was younger, you know, when I wrote to some artists and say, when I have a problem with color, you know what she said? Now, when I have a problem with color, just use purple color, it will work. Why? Sounds funny. Now, after many, many years, then I discover the answer. Right? The answer is here. Okay, the answer is actually here. Now, see, if you have a color, now let's say you use some color. Now, why we use purple color in your work? Because the green color region is very, very big. Unlikely in vector space, you're going to cross in the green color and come back. Right? So likely you will cross in this manner. So you probably around here, and that's why. And then when you cross in this manner, if you have bluish color, you have reddish or yellowish color, you have no choice but to cross over to purple zone. And you unlikely you will cross in green. Yeah, that's the reason why when you use purple color, it always works. You can cross into green, but you're going to do more things. You're going to find more colors in order for you to cross through. Right? It's like travel through a big ocean and come back. Right? But if you're crossing in purple, and that's why it works easily. That's why any color, if it doesn't work, you put some dark brown, pigment, it will work. Yeah, but that's just simple tricks. Not so good, but you're going to understand the reason now. That's the reason. It's a color space vector reason. Right? If you understand mathematics, it's a vector. Okay, so that's why all these brown colors are very, very critical. I don't advise you to go and buy so many from the art shop, but if you can, go mix, buy the paint, it's better. Save your time, you get all the fresh paint and get all of them. You know, if you have money to waste, you know, get all the browns. You need to use it. Yeah. Right. You really can't see it, but actually, this one I want to show you like some subtle difference in color. Unfortunately, lighting here you can't really see it. But this painting is by Corot. You can see a lot of minor difference in gray and brown. And it makes you think like that it's a certain color, but actually it's not. Because we use the color to push each other. It's like just now the chart. You know, if you... Okay, now give you an example. Let's say this color, in the old day, they only have these colors, right? Now, if I want my brown to look more red, what do I do? Now, I will take another color then further away and push it towards that. You know what I mean? Okay, imagine this is like a vector. If you paint this color, you paint that color, this color will force this color towards red. Now, if you want to make it move towards orange, you paint this color next to it, you'll push towards orange. It's like a vector. Okay? So, if you have a brown color, if you paint bluish color next to it, it will turn orange. If you have a same brown color, you paint greenish color next to it, it will turn red. You know what I mean? It's relative. Your eyes, it's called simultaneous contrast if you want the scientific color theory term. Simultaneous contrast. Right? Your eyes will react to both colors together. That's why you can't stare at one thing and paint. Because it's reacting together in pair. In fact, the whole surrounding, not even in pair, it's more than that. Right. So if you want to use color, you're going to look around and not care about things around it. Don't just paint the thing. You won't be able to paint anything. Right. You paint the thing, it's all flat. Because why? You're going to do comparison all the time. This painting, drawing, you draw one by one. But painting, you paint in relationship. It's a bit different. Right. So you can't just paint the thing. Sometimes you push the thing. Yeah. I'll show you my painting. So that's how you use the brown. Okay, so but this picture you can't really see it. Unfortunately, it's a bit gray. Yeah. Even this one. Now this is really nice. Actually, I want to show you this color. Like, it looks like orange on the screen. If you see on the screen, it's actually orange color, right? But actually, it's brown. If you use the Photoshop as tapping, it's actually brown. But it actually looks like orange color here because we use a kind of gray black push on it. So he paints a bit gray black, right? So that's blue. So the brown color turned orange when you look at it. Yeah, this one is by myself. Yeah, I think this one is by myself, yeah. Yeah. That's the one that designed the 1-9 code. Yeah, very very smart painter, German painter. Okay, now there's another one by Akipov. Russian theater. Now look at this, how the hue is used. Okay, now see that? You can't see anything here, right? It's all gray, you can't really see much. The whole piece of cloth is flat, but you can see here the difference. Because it use hue difference here. The tone is the same. But because of the hue difference, you see the color. Same thing over here. Now see that it's pushing the hue difference. Because there's no tonal difference to pay inside the same zone in here. Okay, now this is the way I teach how color can be used. Now, see, if I need to use color, how will you design the reader? Okay, now it's very complicated to give you all the color and you want to design the reader, but you can think about it like this. Imagine it's like you're traveling, but you're not taking the direct flight. Okay, so if you want to use blue and you want to use orange color in the same thing, but you don't take a direct flight, you go around the world before you reach your destination. So you mix a little bit of that color and then you mix a little bit of that color, so it brings you around in space. Imagine this is your color. Your palette, I see you have a color view like palette, no? So when you mix here, you mix the color and then you mix and you let it change slowly before you reach your destination. So that gets you many, many colors. And you can do the vector in different manner. So that's how you design your reader for painting. That's how you get many colors. Okay. Now you will come up with an easier system. Let me show you all these pictures first before we go to the last one. Then I'll show you my system. Now, see, even like people think like Kandinsky paints very colorful painting. Now, if you see carefully, there's a lot of brown. Actually, there's a lot of brown color. All kind of different brown. Now, it's the same thing like what I just mentioned just now. That brown thing. Now, this system is using all these browns to create rhythm. So, if you want certain difference, some difference, more difference, and you use the brown to adjust. So, if you go back to look at Kandinsky now, you really see that. See that? Different type of browns. Now, you can go home and take a few Kandinsky and look at it. There are all kinds of browns in it. Now, if you first try to look at it, oh, it's very colorful. So, we never really pay attention. But if you see carefully, there are all kinds of brown colors there. Some browns are more purple, some browns are more yellow, some browns are more orange. And that's how it creates the rhythmic change, you know, in this picture. And then the same thing in this. You can see that this is like greenish brown. You see that? And then you don't know what kind of gray. I just don't know what the name of the color. Now this is also not the pure color. It looks like red, right? But it's not. See that? There are all kinds of intermediate colors. It looks colorful at first glance. Because why? The purest color shocks the loudest. So you think it's very pure, the whole painting, but it's not. Right? There's a lot of all kinds of browns in there, you see carefully. There's a lot of tinted color, shaded colors in there, right? Now same thing in Matisse painting. It looks very colorful first glance. But you can see some of these colors. See that? These are all the balancing colors. Now even in this, you can see like gray. See like gray, like this kind of green is not pure. See that this kind of green. There are all kinds of intermediate colors you have. It's not the purest color. So this is how you balance the painting with color. The intermediate one that creates all the rhythm for the color. Okay, now this is a system. Now this is how I define my color theory. Okay, now more friends, life is better. Right, so that's why you're here. Okay, now, but if you have only friends, there's no driving force. So sometimes your friend could act a little bit like enemy, push you a little bit, right? Yeah. So I don't tell you that you paint very well all the time, that's not going to help you. Right, you know you paint well, right? So I'm going to give you some critical comments, right? Then you paint better. So I'm going to act a little bit like enemy, right? Sometimes. So this is how I use the system. Now, if you don't know about all this color theory, you can forget about everything. Take your palette up, arrange it properly like a rainbow. Okay? Arrange like a rainbow and learn how to mix colors. Now, if you want to use color, say today you want to use blue color, so look at your palette now, which one is nearer to your blue. So around there, you will form all your friends, including your browns. Including your browns. So you're going to arrange your browns properly also. Okay? Same thing like this, now the browns. Now don't anyhow place your color. Anyhow place your color, you will paint anyhow type of painting. Okay? Sorry. Now, okay, this one. Now see that? You're going to arrange yellowish brown next to yellow. Okay. Now greenish brown next to green. Black next to the blue or purple. And then the dark brown next to purple, red brown next to red orange. Alright? Don't anyhow arrange your palette. It's going to, if your palette is like that, you know how I grade problem for the student? I bring them out the pen at night, they cannot see their color. So they got to memorize their palette. So the week before that, I tell them, you clean your palette, make them nicely, arrange it nicely. But some of them, they didn't do it, so they go at night, they don't know what they're painting. Yeah, because everything looks like brown at night. You don't know what is that, you know? Green looks like brown, purple looks like brown, black looks like brown looks like brown. Right? So they don't know what they're painting, because anyhow, they arrange your palette. So the painting is anyhow. Right? So I get up this exercise, they paint at night, only yellow light, they cannot see anything. So yeah, you have a range of color, you want to paint well. That's very important. Okay, so this is the So this is the system I'm using. Now, see how to do that? Now pretty easy. If you are starting off with color, you're not very familiar, now don't go for the strongest enemy first. Now when you are not very strong in design, all this, fight with smaller enemies. Use the brown of that pure color. Now if you want to contrast blue with orange, instead of contrast blue with orange, don't go for orange, that's the strongest enemy. You will lose the game, right? Fight with the brownish orange first. If you can conquer that, then go for that orange. Or go for smaller amount of orange. Right? So fight with the weaker enemy first until you are strong enough, then go for the strongest enemy. Now doesn't mean that you have all the enemy colors, it would work. It will work, but you have to be really, really, really good in design. And just like the fish just now. Okay, this is the fish. He used all pure color, but he knows how to balance it in design. Now if you are from visual communication and design and graphic design, you know what I'm talking about. Yeah. If you want to use all the pure color, it's going to be very, very good in visual tension control. Right. Okay, so that is, yeah, if you want to study that, look at this paper card, you understand. Yeah. So this is the color system I'm using. And then there are some of my paintings that you see how I use a little bit of different, but I still find the intermediate colors. But you can't quite see, but I bring the actual painting to show you. Maybe you want to get the picture paint. Now this is when you use more colors, but you really got to care about all the intermediate colors and the tension of colors. Okay, some of this part you can't quite see here, maybe I want to show you the actual paintings. Now see, if you use a lot of color, but I create the diagonals and the intermediate colors and all kind of different. Now even I have pure, I have intermediate ones. No, I have the orange base, I have the red base. I have a purple color, it's like same thing, but unfortunately you can see it quite clearly in projection. Yeah. When you use a lot of color, you have to really care about how it creates tension. So it's very tough to turn really easily. Alright, now I'm going to do an exhibition in this university in January. Now if you have time, you can go and see. Now small painting. Yeah, and I printed a book, and I'm going to send 200 copies to Ingrush. So if you go for the exhibition, you go there early, you get the book free. Yeah, but it's a small book. Right. I only brought a few copies to give it to the organizer for their book. Yeah, so I don't have everything. Now if you have any questions, you can feel free to ask. Now, before that, I show you my painting, so it's here. It's there, you can see. Now see that? When I use orange color, I have orange brown, so when I use blue, I have green, and I have greenish brown, and I have some sort of greenish brown, you know. I have all kinds of intermediate color in it, you know. Look at the intermediate color I use, and that's how I link it. Feel free to come and take a look. Same thing, like, you know, it looks like really, really pure. See that? But I have the intermediate one, and then, like, I have it linked with the green, and I have the green linked with the greenish brown, and then the blue color. See that? The green, blue, and all these intermediate colors that are linked together. You can take a look. You can come forward and take a look here. Now, this was painted just now. Now, like I said just now, if you don't know what color to use, use purple color, you won't. Yeah. So that's